Neil deGrasse Tyson, the astrophysicist with the American Museum of Natural History in New York City, on the space and the ethics. First of all, welcome.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me back. It's been just a few weeks, actually.
We chatted
about UAPs a few weeks ago. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I put both questions to you. What is the potential public good of this kind of travel and exploration and research? I know you love research. And what about the larger issues of inequality and ethics?
So I should make a few obvious first points that there has been inequality and hunger and poor and racism and all these problems. All that long predates anybody's attempt to fly in space. So to now look at success in space launches and say, because we're doing that is why we have not solved the rest of these problems is kind of a false equivalence. That's my first point. Second, typically, what we are spending in space is much less than anyone thinks we're spending in space. It's just that space dollars are highly visible compared with other budget items that show up in the annual in the annual portfolio. And so, for example, when we landed on the moon, NASA was, I forgot exactly, 3%, 4% of the federal budget. People said, so that concert, Summer of Soul, we were going to the moon while that concert was happening. And so it's a very visible use of that 4% of the tax dollar. But you didn't hear anybody talk about the rest of the 96% that could be solving poverty or building schools or helping those who were disenfranchised. And so I'm just trying to appeal to people to have a more balanced sense of what parts of the budget you're going to critique. Otherwise, it becomes just fast headlines. We're going to the moon, but I'm hungry. Well, okay, there's a lot of things we're doing while you're hungry, okay, that don't immediately put food on your plate. In a democracy, an elective republic, we vote every year for representatives to then create a budget of things we value. Okay, so there's art. Is art putting food on someone's plate? No, but it creates an environment where you want to live. We do things because that's the identity of the country we want to create. And we're wealthy enough, we can do it all. All. So don't just say, why are we spending there when we should be spending there? Well, let's spend it in both places, period. Now, by the way, I did the math on this. You wanna know how rich Jeff Bezos is? The $200 million dollars is, at last I checked, that's his wealth. If that were dollar bills, you could stack them and they would reach twice the height of his. You found it.
Yeah, that we have your tweet. That's wild.
It will reach twice the height of the elevation that his rocket will attain. Just put that in context. No, you can say, so you can say he shouldn't pay that, but he's got plenty of money. He can do that and 20 other things. So if you want to complain about Jeff Bezos, complain that he's not helping the poor or the hungry or his workers, but that specifically wouldn't have to directly address the fact that he wants to go into space and create an entire new, with along with Branson, an entire new economic branch of what people might do on their vacations, space tourism. And it's now it's just for rich people. But
well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about that part. Yeah. So you're getting us exactly to that next larger question, because new things are often attacked by virtue of being novel and not for any substantive reason. And so to your point, things that were initially thought of as only for the 1%, whether that was the initial air travel or other technology, then has democratized. Walk us through, is there a value to a potential private space travel market?
Well, if it becomes a huge tourist industry, then there's value. All right, it's an economic, a previously underrealized and exploited way you might spend your vacation. Okay, is anyone complaining that you might fork up a few thousand dollars to go to Disneyland? No, you're enjoying yourself. You're not saying, why are you doing that when you could be feeding the poor? No one is creating that equation. So I can imagine a future, it's not hard, where, no, it's not $250,000 to go into space. It's watch the numbers drop as the launches increase in rate. And notice his boosters are getting returned back to the launch pad to be reused. When you fly to Europe in a 747, they don't throw it away and roll out another one. They reuse it. And when you reuse expensive technologies, you drop the average cost. And in so doing, you commoditize what previously was the purview of the rich. We all saw the 1987 movie Wall Street, and there's Gecko on the beaches of the Hamptons with a shoulder-mounted cell phone. And I remember thinking, boy, I wish I was rich. I could have a phone. And yeah, the rich people get it first.
Yeah.
But when everybody gets it, the product's actually better and much cheaper.
They're a lot smaller now.
Yeah. So if things go the way they intend, this becomes a choice that you will make going forward. As you might collect a few vacations worth of money to do that, of course. It will cost more than going to Orlando, for sure. But I don't see anything wrong with opening up an entire new business enterprise. This is America. If you don't think that it should happen that way, that's a different country. You know, rethink what this country is or should be.
So then let's talk public-private. The original space travel was in the Cold War era. It was government-backed in the countries that could do it. This is obviously business. Does anything come to your mind that has been publicly beneficial by having businesses do some of the research and thus pay for some of the investment?
Well, okay, so that happened with aviation. Okay, private enterprise led aviation. And you know who were the first people to fly in airplanes? Rich people. Okay, and the competition to carry the biggest loads or to go the farthest became so intense. All right, and there was prize money rewarding people who achieved these goals that you reach a point where, by the way, my plane is big enough, I can carry people. I can carry a plane load of people to a destination. And you birth an entire industry that is, we can't imagine a world without it. So, and a point about problems on Earth before we go into space, you know what I think of? I think of, let's go back 30,000 years, we're all in the cave, and you want to go outside the cave door. And so you go to the cave elders and say, I want to see what's outside across the valley. No, we have cave problems. You have to solve those first before you exit the cave door. Given the size of the universe and the resources that await us there, in asteroids and comets and energy, I think we got to keep moving that frontier. Otherwise, we'll regress back into the cave from whence we came.
Beautifully put, poetically so. And this is why we kind of wanted to look at the whole big issue, the criticism, and also hear from you. I am out of time, but we do have to disclose one potential conflict, Neil, which is we've been talking about the value of space, but from what I can tell, you've done this entire interview yourself while being in outer space.
Actually, just for the record,
got you.
Earth is in space, and we're all on Earth. So,
dude, wait a minute. Whoa.
Deal with it.
We're in space, man. All right. So you always end with just one more explosion.
The night sky they see when they go up to the high altitude.
Yeah.
You can wait until sunset and see the same sky.
Respect.
Throw that in there.
Dollar bills, y'all. I learned so much today.